All right, welcome everybody. I'm Kat Sheridan from the Ohio Arts Council's Rife Gallery. Today we're going to have a listen to one of our artists, Robyn Schaffer, who is a part of our exhibition After Hours Artwork by State of Ohio Employees. Just a little bit of housekeeping while you're with us. If you have questions, pop it into the chat or the comments and we'll be sure to get to those at the end where we have a Q&A section. Without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Robyn. Enjoy.
All right. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for taking time out of your day to join the art talk. I'm very appreciative of the opportunity to present on paper art and to have participated in the 2021 After Hours Art Show at the Rife Gallery. I wanted to particularly thank Kat Sheridan, the director of the Rife Gallery, and Amy Wisman, the Marketing Exhibition Fellow, for their support, and also Ken Emmerich, who's the exhibition juror, for this opportunity. So a little bit more about me. I am a... Here we go. Wait a minute. Technology. I am a licensed psychologist. I've been a licensed psychologist since 1995. And I've worked for the Ohio Department of Rehabilitation and Corrections for over 21 years. And when I'm not busy working in the criminal justice arena, I am a layered paper artist. So I wanted to talk a little bit about paper because it is rather foundational to layered paper art. Officially, it was invented in 105 AD by a Chinese court official, but in 2006, a fragment of a paper map was actually dated back to 200 BC. Safe to say, paper has been around for a really long time. And over the years, it was interesting reading up more about the history of paper. A lot of countries would almost treat it like a state secret and try to hide how they would produce paper from other countries until they would get overrun and they ended up being forced to share their paper-making techniques. And over time, it did get around to all the different countries and lots of different processes. I thought of interest currently is our new paper has about 36% of the fiber coming from recycled sources, which is good. When paper artists are interviewed, they have a lot of common thoughts about paper. One being that it's a really neat medium because of its accessibility. So most of us, even though, you know, a lot of people or places are trying to go paperless, I still find myself drowned in paper most times, whether it's stuff coming in through the mail or just things you're picking up. And the reality is paper art, you can use a lot of different types of paper in your art. And so the accessibility is nice because no matter where you live or how much money you have, you probably are going to be able to access paper. And paper has a lot of variability. So it comes in different sizes, colors, density. It has different patterns sometimes or textures. You can see on the screen, you know, the impact of like corrugated cardboard versus like a smooth paper, or the two images on the right on the blue are some little pieces I did where I colored paper and then used it to do the layered art versus a black and white version of the layered art. Which is probably my primary format, but they definitely evoke kind of a different feel to them. all paper I find is really fun to create with. And I grew up in a family of people who like to make crafts, build things, create things. And two parents who never found a scrap of paper they ever wanted to throw out. So as time got on and they got older, I inherited quite a bit of paper. I have diaries going back to the 20s and 30s from a great uncle who wrote these amazing diaries. I've got like work papers and log sheets from, you know, the eras in the 40s and 50s, just because they just didn't throw stuff out. So some of those things find their way into some fun projects. What I wanted to do was to take a few minutes to review some different paper artists and different techniques. And you can just get a sense, I would say, of the wide variety. By no means am I covering the field of paper art exhaustively, but it's just tipping our toes into the water of paper art. And you can see that it has a long history. A lot of the paper art began in more probably an affluent population of folks, you know, that it wasn't really accessible to everybody along the economic ladder, but I think that has changed over time as well, which is great. So this is Joanna's work. She's a Dutch artist from the late 1600s, 1700s, so quite a while ago. And she was known for doing these silhouette works. And she would take a piece of paper and cut out a design and cut in such a way to mimic texture and to raise it to a higher art form. And when she would be done with her design, she puts it on a contrasting, or did put it on contrasting background, which would really make it pop. And so you can see in this one, there's like a building and some trees, people, and then she did a border. And she got to be quite well known in her era for being this silhouette artist. Isabel is an artist that lives in Seattle, Washington, and she does what's called a carved book technique. She really appreciates old books, which I would agree with. And but what she, you know, this obviously is not a book you're going to read at this point. So where she found her books were in dumpsters, thrift stores, you know, recycling bins, and she would grab these hardcover books, and with an X-Acto knife, armed with an X-Acto knife, a pen, watercolor, she would create this whole new, you know, fantabulous, fantastical world inside this book. If you look at her images online, you can still faintly see the printed word of the original book. It's sort of faintly in there. But, you know, from this picture, you can tell that it's quite a transformation of a book. Julia is an amazing artist in the world of quilling. And that's a whole nother realm of paper art, quite fascinating. She's from the UK. And basically I was looking at, I haven't done quilling, but I was looking at different YouTube videos, and it's fascinating, you know, basically taking strips of the paper, then winding them super tight, and then deciding how loose or tight you want them, or what shape you want them to be in, you know, using your fingers or tweezers. And by putting each one of those pieces that you see in there that are different colors are actually different paper that has been wound and then shaped and then attached to like a background and to create the image. So it's, this area is quite deep. There's quite a few artists that do quilling, And it has a very long history. It goes back to the ancient Egypt era. And then it used to be done by monks and nuns to make the religious, boxes and things look all fancy, and they would color them in gold and make them look really posh. So this too is a pretty long history paper art technique and quite dramatic. Maud, she's a paper cutter who basically works on a flat sheet of paper, kind of similar to our first artist in a way, but she does tiny purposeful cuts to create that texture in the feathers that you're seeing in these animals and other objects that she creates. It almost to me takes on like a lace-like characteristic, see-through and very dramatic type of work. And she lives in New York State. It's quite interesting. This next artist, really am drawn to. It's probably the color and the repeated design, but Daniel lives in South Africa. You can see on the left, he works, it's actually like a cutout silhouette shape is the outer part of the frame. And then inside, he's doing a repeated pattern that's layered. So as you go down, you know, it's actually lower in the view. But I think it's quite dramatic, mesmerizing in a way. And then the one in the center certainly is eye-popping. And then here's a whole different take on paper art. So the other ones we were talking about where they were layered, they were attaching them to each other. This one is actually layers that do not attach to each other, but instead are suspended. And so they hang in front of each other, creating that dimension. So both of these are pieces of art that I think create a pretty visual impact. So a different take on layered paper, for sure. And then we have Helen, and I find her work very charming and highly entertaining. She kind of creates these little scenes or almost a diorama using paper, a little more of a sculpture, but some layering in it, and kind of just a really fun take on paper art. So we've looked at different paper artists who create products that typically would be hung on a wall to be enjoyed, but paper art is also used in film, or a version of it, I would say. So I just want to take a minute to highlight a couple of films that I routinely go to the Cleveland International Film Festival up in Cleveland, KIFF, and Bill Watterson, who created Calvin and Hobbes, made a movie called Dave Made a Maze. And it is entirely almost consisting of cardboard. So he made this maze in his apartment, and once you enter the maze, everything becomes about cardboard. So the rooms, the structures, the characters, and eventually the actors turn into cardboard puppets. And you can see one of them, that's one of the guys that's, his character was to film what was going on in the maze. So there he is looking through his camera. But they did this in like a long weekend, created this crazy film. And it's just a fun, fun look at what you can do with paper, with cardboard, and imagination. And I wanted to touch on another individual, Irving Harper, who to me, he is the kind of the embodiment of what this art show was, because we are full-time employees who do art after hours. And Irving was a designer for the Herman Miller group back in the 60s and 70s. And after hours, what he did was paper art with a Picasso influence, as you can kind of see maybe on the left. But towards the end of his life, someone went and visited to work on a biography and found that he had 300 sculptures, amazing sculptures of paper art. And so they did create a really neat book called Irving Harper Works in Paper. So if you're interested in seeing his sculptures, I don't know that they ever got shown anywhere. He really just did them for himself and then had them hanging around his house. But they are amazing pieces of art. Another person that kind of had a design influence, I think, in the way I see things is Alexander. And I just like his kind of graphic sensibilities and just having fun with drawing and with lines and just the notion of like things don't have to be what you typically think they would be. So like on the right, those are actually dolls. But those are definitely not ordinary dolls. So I enjoy his stuff immensely. M.C. Escher, what really resonates with me for his work is the puzzle quality and the black and white, gray kind of tones. I think they pull you in. And what I do appreciate, and I think relates to what I do, is they keep the eye highly entertained. Like when I like to look at something, I enjoy being able to spend a lot of time exploring it visually, because there's just a lot going on or different perspectives to look at or something new. So I think it's a really interesting work that he has done. And with the black and white, because that's predominantly what I work in, I will just give a shout out to Vivian Mayer. And this is another film, Finding Vivian Mayer, that I'd recommend. But she was, again, somebody who worked all day and then she incorporated art into her life. So she actually was a full-time nanny. And what she would do is bring her charges with her around the streets of the city, typically Chicago, and be a street photographer. And she would take pictures while she was babysitting the kids. And she came up with just amazing photographs. But again, her black and white work, I think, is very impactful and kind of resonates with what I do. These next two slides are probably the closest influence on me by far, mainly because these two works are done by my Nana and over 50 years ago, probably 50, 60 years ago or more. And I don't know if you can really tell, but it is layered paper art. And what she did, I believe, is she used either repeating craft paper where the scene was repeated, or heavy duty wrapping paper with a repeated design. And then she would layer it to create that dimension and to kind of breathe that life into the scene or the picture. And so those were directly a pretty powerful influence as I thought about something to do with paper. She definitely had her technique down. And here's another image of hers. This is actually a pretty big piece. You can see how old it is because the background paper has literally mind melded into the burlap that it is sitting on. So as it's still hanging in there, but again, it's just a great example of very delicate cutting and layering of paper. many, many years ago. Also for influences, I mean, as with, I would say, most folks, it's the world around you. If you're paying attention, there's stuff coming at you all the time. And what informs what I do would be a lot of architecture. I love it. I like looking at all the different houses, all the different buildings and bridges and you name it. It's pretty interesting, and it can, it just is something you bring in. I mean, you would think a house would just, you know, like there would be more similarities, but how windows are placed or what they look like varies dramatically depending on where you live or what's being done in the building. And I was just watching like a FedEx truck drive by a little while ago, thinking about how cool the shape of that FedEx truck is with their windows and the structure of that truck. And so it really is an endless process. And then nature, you know, because some of my art, I pull in trees and different parts of nature into it. And of course, in nature, that's just endless as well, from little things to big things. I think that's Mount Hood on the left. And, but you know, I love trees. I always wish we had more. The other piece I just wanted to share, as I have this great opportunity to talk, is I think being a psychologist and working in mental health and criminal justice, that piece of me can only, you know, bleed into the artwork that I do as well. Probably not always consciously, but it's definitely there. It just from a foundational standpoint, on the left is Maslow's hierarchy of need. And basically, it's a motivational theory of how people become self-actualized or reach their potential. And that the theory was that certain things need to be in place to really support that process. And one of those needs is having shelter, food, warmth, clothes. So that's on the bottom. That's that physiological need. And then you move up to safety, love and belonging, esteem, and then self-actualization. And then the idea is through a course of a lifetime, you move up and down on those levels. But this is why it's so important that those basic needs be met for all individuals to allow for folks to have that personal growth. And then on the right, just a shout out to Carl Rogers. It's the humanist theory in psychology of just really valuing people where they are and who they are as a person. And I think that's critical. And I would say in criminal justice, it really becomes pretty critical because you're working with people who are, you know, have made some perhaps really bad decisions and have engaged in maybe some really bad behaviors, but that doesn't negate their value as a person. And so on becoming a person and that humanist approach is you're valuing everyone. And so when I worked on my pieces and I'm creating different homes, to me, they kind of represent people. And there's little homes and big homes and fancy homes and modest homes. And there's homes that probably are more stereotypical of even like indigenous populations, how we might represent an indigenous population with like an igloo or something like that. But just kind of seeing that we're really all connected because we're all people at the end of the day. So this was my first piece. What I began with is a ink drawing on tag board, which is a thick kind of paper, pretty sturdy on its own. And when I get that drawing done, then I make copies of it because I'm going to layer that image. And you can see in this one, I almost created like a well, I guess, and than the population is coming around that. But there's probably 15 layers to that image. And then in the right, you can just see some of the different houses and trees. And, you know, the process of making this, I think, is just a intuitive, creative process. Like, you can cut what you want to cut out or leave what you want to leave. There's really no right or wrong way to do it. And I enjoy it because there's a lot of trying to visualize something ahead, like what's this going to look like if I do this or that, or just being able to problem solve, because sometimes you definitely can hit a glitch and challenge you to think through it. This piece I called The Library. I love libraries, love books, but the neat thing about libraries is, to me, they contain all those different worlds and different people and different places. And even if you're not gonna travel, you can travel at the library. And so this one was created using some printed paper that I got from IKEA. And then I wanted to create little worlds that you might find from different books. So I created little sections and then created, you know, different houses within those sections. And again, you know, just hoping to kind of convey, I think, all the fun things you can find in a library. This is an up close view. So you just get a sense of some of the cutting that can be done. And like I said, there's not really any right or wrong. Probably it's good to have patience if you're going to do paper layer cutting, and some dexterity, I guess, with really small things sometimes, but it is fun. And I find that from the drawing, which is very flat, and then when you create the layers to the art, it's almost like you're breathing life into this picture. It takes on a whole new feel to it. This is one of my favorite pieces. It's actually quite small. It's about like 3 inches by 5. So it's a tiny one, which, you know, the smaller it is, it's a little harder to cut out all the details. But what I liked about it is could sync images down into it, which was a different, kind of a different approach to it. So you can see the drawing on the left and then kind of get a sense of, like, even here, I didn't layer things equally. Some things are higher than others. So things were popping out, and then there's actually an outline of a Native American teepee right in the middle, but it's literally sunk into the image, almost like it's being overtaken by the houses. I was experimenting with faces. And doing some layered art with faces. I kind of, obviously, it was not realistically creating faces. Hopefully, it would be pretty interesting if we looked like this, but they were kind of fun to work with, and their hair in particular, or beards, and ended up being a fun little project. And this is another one of houses kind of crammed together in sort of a tumbling format. And it allowed for a lot, and this is a lot bigger than the small one I showed you. So it was, you could get into doing a lot more intricate cutting with it and layering. And this one has a lot of layers to it too. Some things are pretty low and some things were elevated quite high. And kind of just gives it a different impact. This particular piece is bigger. It's actually at the Ohio Craft Museum right now on display. And I like it because, you know, I think it just sort of reflects that interconnection we have. You know, today something happens anywhere in the world, pretty much like 5 minutes later, we're all informed on it. And sometimes a little too much, but we're all up on it. So there is this interconnection we have, and you can see it did a bunch of roads and just again creating different neighborhoods and houses and structures. So when you have a big piece like this, for myself, there's just a lot to look at. So to me it doesn't get too boring, and it sort of satisfies that puzzle piece. This one, I decided to harken back to my Girl Scout days and do some paper mache work. I hadn't done in a while, but my dad had been in the Army Reserve and in intelligence, and somehow he had a box full of maps, like just of different countries around the world, actually. So I used those maps, cutting them into strips, and used them for the paper mache part, creating half a world, and then watercolor for the color. And the tree is the center, to me, kind of representing nature or our environment. And then here's all these industries or houses. And, you know, it's just something we probably do need to pay attention to as global warming occurs, or, you know, there's a lot of different documentaries on how populations can impact our environment and just being mindful of the decisions we're making, I guess. But that ended up being kind of a fun piece. And it moved me on to looking at creating paper pieces, layered paper art that would stand on its own. So I took the image I drew and then reversed it so I could copy it going both directions so that I could put it back to back. And then I actually did the layering identical. So you would see the same image no matter what side you were looking at. And that was for the world on a spring, which is at the current exhibit at the Rife. This was really fun and challenging to do. So that's a paper mache ball out of that, out of the maps. And it is attached to a antique bed spring, which is attached to 100+ old wood block. And it was very interesting trying to get that to attach in a way that made sense, but we got it. And it was kind of neat because it's very responsive to air movement. I mean, it just sort of bobs and, you know, flows even if you just walk by. And then I just attached the different structures I had made around that globe. Now, I finished this probably in October before the pandemic. And after the pandemic hit, I kind of laughed because to me, it kind of looks like the virus a little bit, you know, but this was done before that. And it also looks like we're doing social distancing on it. So I thought it had some real current relevancy, but I was just really wanting to represent kind of, again, this connectivity around the world, something we all have in common. Another piece that's in the show currently is called Reflections. And they are not identical. So I guess it's reflections of different things, but they are connected by, it's like little, almost like little pathways connect the two designs. So this picture could be hung either direction. It's not really one up or down. And I use bright yellow corrugated cardboard on the background. And I have to say, I felt like it really made the design pop in a way that the I had been using cork kind of, I think, did not make it pop in quite the same way. So it was kind of neat to see this on that paper. And this is another one that has a lot of just visual interest looking at it. It's a little challenging, I think, to convey in photography, but in person, it's kind of a fun one to look at. And this one is a really neat one. I think I call it Faces or Traveling. And basically, I took one of the faces I had been doodling and playing around with and made it the focal point. But if you think about it, this is an individual who is kind of traveling and seeing things around their environment. So they've got the road going around their head. And then we've got some cars and trucks and even an alien spaceship, which apparently is right on time for the current topics of UFOs. So must have known. And then there's houses and, you know, nature kind of following along the outskirts of the road. So to me, it's a fun piece. It's a happy piece. You know, what do you see when you go out? You know, what are you paying attention to? And I find just like people are infinitely complex and individualized, so are our spaces that we inhabit often, you know, and it's where how we live kind of reflects an awful lot about us sometimes too. So it can be very informative. This is a shot to just give you an idea of, this is the last one I completed. And you can kind of get a little more sense of the process. So this one was stacked very thick because it actually has three levels in one piece. And so by having the three levels, you just had to keep adding and adding layers. And on the right, there's a, you can see I use double stick foam to create the layer, the space in the layers. And using that, I think, also makes it a very sturdy, by the time I'm done, the piece, you know, it's a very sturdy piece. It would be hard to hurt. And so there's an angle shot. And again, you can kind of see the depth. And that one more straight on shot. So this is the piece where the center rectangle is actually pretty low in the item. And then it has the next layer around it is the next, you know, the higher up layer. And then the outer layer is the highest layer. And again, I use that yellow to create some of that pop. So you can see my work at the Mansfield Art Center and the Ohio Craft Museum. And you could also reach me at Robyn Paper Art at Outlook.com.
Wonderful. Okay, so now we have our time for Q&A. So if folks want to go ahead and ask their questions in the chat or in the comments, we'll be happy to screen those. We've had a couple of comments and someone was asking about the recording. We do record all of our talks, and those are available at the Ohio Arts Council's YouTube page, as well as on Facebook. So have no fear if you have to boogie out of here, you do have access to this recording. So let's take a look at a couple of the comments that we've had thus far. I know early on, we had some comments from folks that love seeing all the different artists. And Jennifer mentioned that it's an amazing connection to your Nana's layered paper art and how wonderful it is to see that. And then Catherine was mentioning that she really enjoyed the shadows created on the stand from the world on a spring. So really talking about that shadow play that you have as part of your work as well. And then Jennifer just mentioned that I really enjoy how the viewer's angle or different perspectives give such a reward and surprise. It's absolutely true. I see that in, you know, you mentioned that it is hard to photograph the work. And when you have such intimate work that is so detailed and layered, you can't just get the richness of it from a straight on angle. You have to have a few additional detail shots to get the extent of the work. Mm-hmm. So tell us a little bit about how your work balances, your artwork, your moonlighting work, balances your day-to-day work. Help us understand that kind of connection. You touched on it quite a bit, but I would love a bit more on that, if you wouldn't mind.
I think another common thread through paper artwork is it tends to be very meditative. There's something really, relaxing and just kind of recharging of you too, is spending that time cutting these designs out and working with the pieces, and then just imagining what you can create, and then seeing the finished product. In many ways, like, you don't get the aha until it's done, because when it's halfway done, it's still kind of looking, you know, like, it's not really there yet. But it's really neat to see the drawing come to life with the finished product. But I find it very relaxing and just thoroughly enjoyable.
And you'd say it would enrich your day to day, right? So like,
oh,
it
absolutely
gives you that balance.
Wonderful. Oh yeah, definitely.
So we have a really,
it can be so stressful at work sometimes. So it's really nice to come to something you have a lot of control over. So that too,
absolutely.
You know, there's so much in corrections or mental health or life in general that you cannot control. I will say, you know, doing projects like this is definitely under your control and choosing how you approach it and what you do with it.
Yeah, that's great. We have a really formal question from Debbie, who's curious, do you replicate the full illustration on every level?
No, I mean, I guess yes and no. Like the design is still there, but where it's at or how it's represented is probably not similar from piece to piece to piece on the design. So I think the integrity of the design is still there, but it you know, not everything's even on the same level or layered the same way or anything like that. Yeah.
Great.
That answers that.
I think so. Amy has a question, and she's curious if you could talk about your interest in creating surfaces that become a visual playground. So thinking about kind of like Easter eggs, and you talk a lot about having visual interest in these really busy spaces where you can kind of get lost in that. Are you placing Easter eggs for people to find, or can you talk a little bit about how you're thinking about these really detailed, rich environments, and what are you rewarding your artists with or your viewers with?
Yeah, I think it's I'm very visual, and I like things to be very layered or complicated. I'm not sure that's the right word, but I really like visual puzzles or just a visual world that has a lot going on. I find it very rewarding that when you're done, there really just is a lot to look at because things are treated differently all over the design. And so you're not going to have, oh, I've already seen that, or yeah, that was done there. It just allows you to kind of, I don't know, it almost interacts like a puzzle in a way.
That's great. Catherine would like to know if you start with an idea of what the drawing will be, or is it more organic?
I am, all my coworkers can probably attest to excessive doodling during meetings. So I do spend a lot of time doodling, small doodles actually. Jennifer said yes. but I'm always running scenarios in my head, like, oh, I'd like to try this, or I want to try that. And I always want to be doing something different. So I don't really, I want the challenge of like a totally different approach or design, sort of like adding the paper mache was just a whole nother, like, wow, okay, this is very interesting. It's a whole different kind of approach to displaying the paper art. Taking the roads out and kind of just having tumbling houses. I ended up really liking that, but that was really a different approach. So I usually just have an idea in my mind and I'll just sit down and draw. And the nice thing with that type of drawing is you really can't make a mistake because it's just whatever. So that part is more probably just intuitive.
That makes sense. So take us a little bit through a day in the studio with you. What does that look like? How do you prepare for it? How long is it in the day? Where is it?
Yeah.
Give us a flavor of what studio practice is for you.
Sure. Well, we're lucky enough when we moved down to Columbus, the house we got has a sunroom. So I'm surrounded by all these windows and I have taken over a good half, if not more, of that room. And I basically just have a table set up, and then in that room I have all my supplies. I have, you know, the papers, I have, you know, just the tools I need. I use an X-Acto knife, all the equipment's there. So, you know, after work, I will just, when I have projects going on, just sort of camp out at the table, and I can just spend hours doing it. A lot of times I'll be listening, to radio, or I might even have the TV on, but I'm not watching it. I'm just kind of working on the paper project. And so it goes through stages of, you know, drawing it and then getting the copies I need and then thinking about how to construct it and then working on putting it together. So some projects take longer than others, but that would be me bending over trying not to get a sore neck, because you know, sometimes you do have to get pretty darn close to see what you're doing. But that's kind of the process.
I think Catherine would like a little more kind of detail. If someone is curious and wants to play with this medium, what have you found to be the best between the layers, or any other kind of like pro tips?
Yeah, my Nana used some type of glue. And so initially I was trying to use some type of glue, and I could not find something that would be thick enough to hold it up the way I wanted it to, because I wanted to use heavy paper. What she was using was extremely thin paper for hers, but I wanted something more solid. So I ended up finding it's a double stick, like a sticky on both side foam strips. So I do have to I have little scissors and you have to cut a tiny bit of foam to fit what you're doing, you know, depending on the size you need. But that's between cutting the paper and then sometimes cutting that foam and then getting it where you need it to be can be the trickier part at times. But that's probably getting that double-sided foam helped. Getting the right kind of paper helps.
So that's great. I think that'll be helpful for Catherine. And she noted that her Nana did that too. So that's good. Amy is curious, was paper the first art material you've worked with, or one, was it the first art material you worked with, or the one that really drew you in? And is paper the final frontier, or are there other media you're looking to experiment with next?
This is probably the most serious I've been doing art is with the paper. Besides, I do dabble with photography and collage work. I have a fantastic dog, Shadow. I'll give him a shout out here. He's now 15 and a half years old, but he was a wonderful model for many years. And I could get him to hold a cigar or wear a hard hat or whatever. And then I would collage him onto like the sewing pattern outfits from the 60s and 70s. So I use those to then create characters and create worlds for him to be standing in. So he has been my muse for quite a while. And that's a huge fun outlet for making greeting cards and just really fun, fantastical images. I'm having fun with the paper art. I'm on to a current new project that's kind of taking it in a different direction. So I think as long as I can keep making it interesting and novel for myself, I will be pursuing it for a while, yes.
Yeah, I think you hit on something really important there, that all of the artists that have had talks through this exhibition and really any of our exhibitions is this insatiable curiosity. Like your work is driven by the curiosity of either material or concepts. And
yes.
The other thing that I find particularly interesting about your work is that there is a large dose of whimsy in it, but it also has, if you're willing to take the time to think about it and really consider it, there's some heavy subject matter. So can you talk a little bit about how and why you are approaching it in this way?
Well, I think, a lot of times if you go full force forward with heavy material, you're actually pushing people away. It can be a little too much to approach, I guess. And I think having the work be more whimsical allows people to come into it and maybe think about those things. And they are in there, but I think it's probably just more my nature too, that I'm not going to be be quite that forward, I guess, in a way.
Well, it certainly allows folks to approach the work as themselves fully. Like there's a draw-in that, you know, and you can take away and move through concepts as it makes sense for yourself. So that's, you know, that's a way of honoring people's individuality that's really nice. I am curious about this new direction that you're pursuing. Do you mind sharing a little bit about it?
No. All right. So I noticed on the last piece, I did just a tiny bit of where I was putting images where I thought I had finished, but I didn't finish them. I kept, I had space and then I added more layers to it. And this would probably be hard to explain. So this new one, I'm going to have a single road And on that single road, I'm going to layer up and down on that road. So it'll be like cars, then trees, houses, and then maybe trees, and then maybe big buildings, but they're all going to consist on one road behind each other. So it'll be very thick. But I think it'll be interesting to see how it works, where it's not like just a flat image in a sense, that the really trees are typically in front of a house or behind a house, and the cars are in front of the house and beside the house and things like that. So we'll see how that turns out. It's yeah. definitely more exploratory, but I think it'll be fun.
It's interesting because what you're explaining has a diorama
yes.
idea to it, right?
Right.
And so it's so interesting to think about the origination of a very flat surface 2D and how you are manipulating that into this three-dimensional experience that's best experienced in person. The same with dioramas, right? Like you can't get the whole feel unless you're there with it or have some sort of video of it. I am curious, is there anything that you want to leave with us about your work or pursuing creativity and how that influences? Any parting thoughts that you have?
No, just like what you said before, like being curious, you should, I think, treasure that curiosity and playfulness and openness and just, you know, even if you don't move too far from where you're at, there's neat things going on all around you. So it's really just taking that in and experimenting and just try. I mean, what's the worst that's going to happen? You know, it's fun to try.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for that, Robyn. Robyn Schaffer, thank you for this great artist talk, all of the inspiration and wonderful artists that you shared, as well as your great work. I think that you have given at least a few folks some springboards into their own creativity and curiosity, and we are very grateful for that. I also want to give a special thank you to Ken Emmerich, our juror for this exhibition, to our governor, to the legislature, and to the OAC board, who supports this great space that allows us to amplify artists' voices. And for those of you that would really love to see this exhibition in person, we will have an open house for the very last opportunity in the gallery. If you'd like to come, it's between noon and 4 on July 10th, and that's a Saturday. So thank you all so much for joining us. Have a great rest of your day.